So I'll be talking about body building, or shall we call it kidney damaging. We'll start with a case presentation which actually provoked my interest in this subject. A 26-year-old male with no past medical history presents to the ER with nausea and vomiting, fatigue and arthralgia for the last 4 weeks. He reports multiple ER visits, receiving supportive care, IV fluids, paracetamol, and he did receive 2 injections of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications. Physical exam, his blood pressure is 135 over 80, well-built muscular male, weight is 88 kilograms, height 177 centimeters, BMI of 29, and he had a normal exam except for a pretty tender upper abdomen. Workup was basically normal except for a serum creatinine of 1.9 mg per deciliter. His urine sediment is benign with no proteinuria. His CPK is normal. He had elevated uric acid of 9.2, normal serological workup, and normal renal ultrasound. He has been following an extensive bodybuilding training program for the last 2 years. Uses high protein diet, reaching 3 grams per kilogram per day, daily creatine supplements, and multiple vitamins. He did use anabolic steroids 2 years ago, but nothing over the last 18 months. He wasn't very forthcoming in telling us what he used, so his brother volunteered collecting all supplements at their home and bringing them, and this is what we found. Some were bought from local places, some over the internet. So let me start by a quick introduction about performance-enhancing drugs. This is really becoming a serious global public health problem. In a meta-analysis of 187 studies, the overall global lifetime prevalence is 3.3%, more in men than women. What's alarming is that the weight is higher actually among recreational athletes, young teenagers and adolescents trying to look better, than professional athletes. The weight varied by region. The highest is in the Middle East, 22% compared to 2-5% in other regions. The Middle East is the first one, 21.7%. The list is very long, including androgens, anti-estrogens, aromatase inhibitors, beta-HCG, growth hormone, growth factors, erythropoietin, and glucocorticoids. Anabolic androgenic steroids have been used since the 50s by athletes who desire to increase muscle mass and decrease body fat and improve performance and enhance physical attractiveness. All androgens produced for human and veterinary purposes have been taken by athletes. Their side effects include cardiac hypertrophy, dyslipidemia, erythropoiesis, mood disorders, and in men, decreased testicular volume and decreased spermatogenesis, hypogonadism, and gynecomastia. And women, side effects include virilization. Other than hormonal agents are also used. It's a long, long list. This is not an unusual scene to be encountered in major pharmacies and local shops. So what do we know about the renal side effects? Really not much in the literature. What we know about them is basically from case reports and case series. The largest is this one. This is development of focal segmental glomerulosclerosis after anabolic steroid use. This is published in JASN in 2010 from Columbia University and Mass General. They had 10 bodybuilders, 6 white and 4 Hispanic, none of them are black, who used anabolic steroids for a long time. They presented with proteinuria on a mean 10 grams per day and a renal insufficiency mean creatinine of 3. 3 patients had full-blown nephrotic syndrome. The renal biopsy in the 10 patients, 9 had FSGS, 4 also had glomerulomegaly, 1 had only glomerulomegaly, and 3 had collapsing FSGS, 4 had perihilar lesions. 8 of the patients were managed to be followed up for more than 2 years, 1 progressed to end-stage renal disease, 7 received RAS blockade, and all 7 patients discontinued anabolic steroids, leading to weight loss. serum creatinine and reduction in proteinuria. One patient got depressed after 1 year of abstinence and resumed his exercise program and anabolic steroids with relapse of proteinuria and renal insufficiency. This is the patient. He allowed publication of his picture. And look at the correlation between proteinuria, creatinine, discontinuation of the supplements, improvement in renal parameters. He re-challenged his body with worsening of proteinuria and creatinine. This is the biopsy finding. Interestingly, they had a significant food process effacement in more than 90%. So this was the first series of patients who developed FSGS after long-term use of anabolic steroids. Unlike patients with post-adaptive FSGS, they had a collapsing variant, they had significant food process effacement. As we know, the classic histologic finding in secondary FSGS mediated by adaptive responses are glomerular hypertrophy and predominantly perihilar lesions of segmental sclerosis with typically less than 50% food process effacement. So the authors reviewed some human and animal studies suggesting that androgens may be toxic to podocytes. Androgens can lead to mesangial matrix accumulation and podocyte depletion independent of structural and functional adaptation. Androgen receptors have been identified in microdissected murine glomeruli and cultured mesangial cells. Exogenous testosterone administration increased androgen receptor expression as well as messenger RNA levels of the profibrotic cytokine TGF-beta-1. Androgens are also known to induce exertive stress and upregulate components of the RAS system. An animal model of hypertension induced in organ damage showed significant attenuation of renal damage by androgen receptor blocking with flutamide. But there are no human studies that have directly addressed the potential role of androgens in podocyte stress as predisposing hemodynamic factor in the development of FSGS. The second case series is acute kidney injury associated with androgenic steroids and nutritional supplements in bodybuilders. This is published in CKJ in 2015. Four bodybuilders abused anabolic steroids, high protein diets. They were all biopsied and they had ATN. 4 weeks after discontinuation of the injections and supplements, their creatinine improved. Two patients had biopsies showing more than 30% interstitial fibrosis and tubular atrophy. They had really high protein intake, reaching to 4 grams per kilogram per day. Their urine analysis were normal. They had no proteinuria compared to the previous series where they had FSGS. None of them were hypercalcemic or took large doses of vitamin D, and none of the biopsies showed nephrocalcinosis. So ATN and interstitial fibrosis. This is one case report in a 27-year-old man presenting with dizziness and fatigue. He used anabolic steroids and beta 2 agonist. He presented pretty late with creatinine of 1,000 millimole per liter, and his biopsy showed global glomerulosclerosis in 10 out of 12 glomeruli and diffuse chronic tubular or interstitial damage. He used high protein commercial diet with more than 2 grams per kilogram body weight, creatine supplements, testosterone, and clenbuterol, which is a beta 2 adrenal receptor agonist, and he started hemodialysis. Let's go back to our patient. Our patient's serum creatinine was high, 13.5 mg per deciliter. His phosphorus was 3.3. His PTH suppressed, 7 picogram per ml. His 25 vitamin D level was above toxic level, 150 nanogram per ml. So after further questioning about vitamin D intake, he admitted using IM vitamin injections. He was not sure about their name or components. He used it 2 injections in 2 different muscle groups over the last 6 months. Again, we used his brother as an investigator to get us what kind of vitamins he was receiving. And this is what he was taking. A veterinary formula of multivitamins used for cows and bulls. Each 100 ml vial vitamin A, 5 million units of vitamin D, and 6,000 units of vitamin E. He refused a kidney biopsy. CRKD continued to rise despite supportive care. We had to use short course oral steroids on him, and slowly he improved. 1 month after presentation, his calcium was down to 9.3 and CRKD 1.1. Unfortunately, he lost follow-up after that. So, in literature, there are a couple of cases similar to my case. This is one from Brazil. Hypercalcemia and acute kidney injury caused by abuse of a parenteral veterinary compound containing vitamin A, D, and E. This is a patient who is 19 years old. He did receive multiple injections of this multivitamin. He did it twice a month for a year. This amount was actually greater than what is recommended for adult bulls, according to the package insert, which says they have to use it 5 ml every 90 days. The interesting part is that the aim of the vitamins is not the vitamins. The aim is the local effect of the oily vehicle. The swelling produced by the injection resulted in a silicone-like effect, which gave the impression of bigger muscles. So they use it because of the vehicle and the bulking of the muscles, and that's why they have to repeatedly use it to keep that effect. This particular patient had similar biochemical markers as my patient. This is another report of two cases having acute kidney injury due to anabolic steroids and vitamin supplement abuse. The two patients used vitamin D formula similar to the one prescribed before. They had AKI with a serum creatinine of 3.9 and 1.9. Their kidney biopsy showed inflammatory interstitial nephritis and ATN with calcium deposits. Again, they used the similar compounds, and they reported having taken 50 ml once a week for the past month, and presented with a similar picture of vitamin D intoxication and hypercalcemia. They did have ATN, and they had some calcium deposits on their biopsies. This is another case with a similar presentation. The interesting part, this patient had a left kidney stone, nephrocalcinosis of the biopsy, and when they imaged his muscles, there is a local reaction with pockets of calcifications at the site of the injections. Quick review about creatine. This is the most popular nutritional supplement used for performance enhancement. It is used to improve training and performance of short duration, high intensity exercise. Creatine is available in a wide range of commercial products, primarily as a powder. It's derived from three amino acids: methionine, glycine, and arginine. 95% is stored in skeletal muscles, with the remainder being located in the brain, testes, and kidneys. It is not recommended for adults and athletes, although many use them in our gyms. Creatine monohydrate is recommended to be used as a loading dose of 20 grams for 5 days and maintenance of 3 grams. The side effects include weight gain from increased water retention, reduced joint mobility and muscle cramping, and GI upset. Although it is considered to be safe, it should not be given in patients with underlying kidney disease or other nephrotoxic agents. I could find a couple of reports linking creatine when it was used solely by young athletes causing interstitial nephritis. This is in the New England Journal of Medicine. A 20-year-old man who was previously healthy, he used higher doses than recommended and presented with hypertension, creatinine of 2.3, and he had a renal biopsy revealing acute focal interstitial nephritis and focal tubular injury. This is another report, the effects of the recommended dose of creatine monohydrate on kidney function. A healthy 18-year-old man only used creatine at the recommended doses, and he had an acute kidney injury with a biopsy showing acute tubular necrosis. We can separate hypertension in this group of patients and subsequent kidney disease. Hypertension in athletes is not well studied, Elevated blood pressure is the most common cardiovascular abnormality identified during the pre-participation exam. There is no known increased risk of hypertension in weightlifters or other strength athletes. Although blood pressure measured in strength athletes during static resistance movements such as weightlifting can be dramatically elevated, and there are case reports where blood pressure reaches 480 over 350 millimeter mercury during the static exercise. And there are two cases of aortic dissections reported with such high blood pressure. My conclusion today, this is just to shed light on this problem. Abuse of performance enhancing agents is a major public health problem affecting young recreational athletes more than professional athletes. Long-term renal effects remain unclear, but case series and reports have linked them to ATN, acute interstitial nephritis, FSGS, and advanced glomerular sclerosis. We really need to educate ourselves about these products, and we need to raise awareness and highlight their dangers, especially to young adults